50s and 60s rock and roll. I'm Brittany, this is Stella, and so there's a lot of memorable people in the 50s and 60s, but we're specifically going to focus on Chuck Berry, Elvis Presley, and the Beatles. And we're going to start off with Chuck Berry.
So Chuck Berry was born on October 18, 1926. He had dropped out of high school at the age of 17 with some of his two friends because he was never really good at school, and then he was really not interested. He went from 1947 to 1950 to jail for armed robbery. He hijacked a car and then he gunpointed a convenience store. And then in February 1962 to October 1963, he got arrested for a violation of the Mann Act, which is transporting an underage female across like state lines, which means that he like met this 14-year-old girl when he went on it was just pretty much like a runaway girl where him and his band stopped in Mexico. And he invited her to work for him at a nightclub that he performed in St. Louis. So she ended up coming back with him, but she had told him that she was 21. But when they came back to St. Louis, they found out that she ended up being 14. So he got arrested for 3 years, and then he was fined for $10,000. The third time he was arrested was in 1979. He did 3 months, and then that was for tax evasion. So how his music career started. So despite all these incidents, he did have major accomplishments, and that was with all his music. He started playing hard blues in the early high school years by winning a talent show. He took up playing the guitar after his high school production. In 1952, he began playing at a bar with songs from country to blues. And then in 1955, he went on a road trip to Chicago, and he got a chance to meet his idol, which was Muddy Waters. He talked about a record label, and then he ended up referring him to his label, which was Leonard Chess. And then he came back to Chicago because he didn't have any of his music that he was performed, so he came back to do an audition. And that was with one of his original songs, Maybelline. And this is by
charts. The title of it is Maybelline.
That song was the one that caught Chess's attention, and then Chuck was signed to Chess Records in the summer of 1955. the rhythm and blues became popular and it blended with country music, creating rock and roll. Since rhythm and blues were considered to be black music, it was not welcome in the white communities. Rock and roll was influenced, was the one that influenced major, the teenage group. So Chuck Berry was one of the first black musicians to do well with the white audience. He was the sight and sound of a black man playing white hillbilly music, and that's the way that people described him. So since country was popular with the white people, he began to come to the shows, and almost 40% of clubs he performed at would be filled with whites. He broke the race barrier between the two, and then he continued. He continued his success with hits such as Brown Eyed Man, Too Many Monkey Business, and then Johnny B. Good. His last album was released in 2017, in the same year that he passed away from natural causes. He was 90 years old. Chuck Berry was one of the few artists that made a huge impact on music. And then, so with Christmas time around the corner, here's one of Chuck Berry's Christmas.
Also known as the King of Rock and Roll, he was born January 8th in 1935 in Tupelo, Mississippi. He actually got started playing music at a contest and he won at 10 years old. And then a year later, he got his very first guitar and he self-taught himself. But when he was in high school, he would do little talent shows here and there, but ultimately he went to school to become a certified electrician. And then I think it was in about 1953, he quit that job and then he paid like $4 to make two records. And then he hired a manager and he released his very first album. I think it was Heartbreak Hotel. And after that, he just started being on the top of the charts for 3 weeks and then it went to 2 years. And, Harbor Hotel actually sold 300,000 copies when it was first released, and then it went on to like over 1 million. And he's known as the King of Rock and Roll because majority of his records, I think it was over 200 records, they went gold, platinum, and multi-platinum. So a popular thing about Elvis was that was a sex symbol. So oftentimes when he would dance around while performing, he would gyrate his hips and he was known as Elvis the Pelvis, and it would drive like a bunch of teen girls wild, including my grandma. So I think it was about in like the late 1950s, 57, he ended up signing a movie deal, and it was for Love Me Tender, and I think that was like a 7-year contract. But after he made that movie, he made over $22 million in merchandise, according to the Wall Street Journal. And what do when you make that much money? Anyone?
You spend it.
Yeah.
You
buy, you actually buy a house, but first I'll show you his dance. I mean, you're not wrong. This is one of his movies, Jailhouse Rock. Just to emphasize, like, the way he moves his hips, the gyrating.
Everybody let it roll.
father. I mean, it's working it. So this was the house that he bought, Graceland. Actually, today it's a museum, but it's a house fitting for a king. You can see the pillars up in front, and it's two stories, so very Grecian. But after that, in, I believe it was 1958, he was drafted to the army for 2 years, where he served in Germany. And then it was actually in Germany where he met his wife, Priscilla. And I think at the time she was 14, and she was adopted by a colonel over there. But once he came back from the war, she was heartbroken because he left her over there, but she begged her parents to let her come over here with him, and they eventually got married at Graceland. So when he came back, he had his fame and fortune and of course his screaming fans, and then he mostly focused on making more movies and music for his fans. And I just wanted to again accentuate how much the fans loved him. He was on a show that was Frank Sinatra's show, but this was right when he came back from the war, so all his fans were like excited to see him. So you can hear the screaming fans. Funny because in that clip I skipped it, but Frank Sinatra is actually like, "Oh, I think that you didn't miss anything while you were at the war because everything stayed the same." So, and he said, "All that's missing is your sideburns." But after this, he started to become more, I guess, paranoid, and he would wake up having nightmares about losing his fame and fortune. And then because of his strenuous schedule and late nights of working, doctors prescribed him tons of pills. And he would, often as artists do, he abused them. And over time, he got, I think it was an enlarged heart and kidney failure. And when they found him in his home in Graceland, he was unconscious, and they were unable to resuscitate him at the hospital. Died actually at the age of 42, so I think it was about 10 years later after he came back from the war, he died after that. But you can see even in his funeral, huge procession of cars and fans alongside in Memphis, Tennessee, and where he was buried, there's just tons of flowers, and again, the whole fitting for a king with the pillars around his gravesite. So, but later on, his body was moved to Graceland by his dad. Yeah. So, okay. Okay, and so now we're gonna move over to the 60s, and I present to you a talented group that's not the Crickets, but the Beatles, and you have most likely heard of them because everyone everyone has heard of them from young to older, and they boomed through their this time period called the Beatlemania because they just boomed with popularity. And so the four members are John Lennon, Paul McCartney, George Harrison, and Ringo Starr. Okay, before we get to the political stuff, this is some background. So in the 60s, it started off with pretty uniform fashion, where they had like pretty neutral colors and really conservative. But through the 60s, the U.S. overwent a movement called the counterculture movement, in which people were questioning politics and just going wild. And as you can see, one of the Beatles songs, "Come Together," it kind of like describes the fashion of the time. So they began to let their hair grow out. So as you can see right here, got his hair down to his knees, and many of the Beatles members did have long hair. Okay.
historical stuff. In the 60s, they were overwhelmed with the counterculture movement, as explained earlier. They were also heavy at war in Vietnam, which many people opposed. And the Beatles did portray some songs in which they wanted to end the war and they wanted peace. And they also had civil rights movements and a campaign for nuclear disarmament. And the Beatles portrayed some of their music, or portrayed some of the topics in their music. So the Beatles were not political theorists, but they did have political, they were political strategists. And in practice, consciousness raising, lobbying, and patronage, and so civil disobedience. Nevertheless, they legitimized pop music and as a means of political expression. And so here we have one of their songs. Well, just some honorable mentions, but this is one of their songs that portrays the peace. For visiting our museum, and be sure to check out our gift shop. And we do have a few trivia questions that you guys want to ask.
Do you want to ask one first?
Me? Okay. Sorry. Okay. This one's fine. Okay. Well, if you guys want candy canes, we have candy canes for you, and
we have a lot of these drinks.
Can grab them. Thank you.